We now come to a whole new section about the p-n junction, and in this video I will give you an overview why a p-n junction is important for a solar cell. The learning objectives of this video are to understand principles of the photovoltaic effect and the role of a junction in a solar cell. This will be a recap of our video on the photovoltaic effect earlier, but here we will explain why a junction of p-type and n-type semiconductor materials is necessary to achieve that photovoltaic effect. A crystalline silicon solar cell is typically made of a wafer of silicon that serves as the light absorber. In most crystalline silicon solar cells used in industry, this wafer is p-type. What you see now is a p-type crystalline silicon wafer acting as a light absorber with front and back electrical contact. When the p-type crystalline silicon is illuminated, light is absorbed in the wafer. The absorption of the light results in an electron-hole pair generation. We will hope that the electron and the hole will separate spontaneously and one of the charge carriers, for example electron, will move towards the front and the other hole to the back electrical contact. If it were as we wish, electrons would be gathered at the front contact and holes would be gathered at the back contact. Then the front contact would be negatively charged relative to the back contact. However, this does not happen in reality. When light shines on the p-type crystalline silicon, it is indeed absorbed by the wafer. Then we do get an electron-hole pair. What happens in reality is that both the electron and the hole will wander throughout the material randomly because of the thermal motion. In reality, there is a high chance that the electron meets the hole and they annihilate each other, or as we say, they recombine. With this solar cell, we would be able to absorb light, but we could not collect any separated electrons and holes at the electrodes. This is the schematic picture of a crystalline silicon solar cell in which n-type and heavily doped p-type regions are added to the p-type crystalline silicon wafer. If you still remember, we need the n-type crystalline silicon to act as the semi-permeable membrane that allows to separate and collect only electrons. Besides, we need a heavily doped p-type crystalline silicon to allow the separation and collection of holes only. At the junction of p-type and n-type crystalline silicon layer, a region called the depletion region is created. The other depletion region is formed between the p-type crystalline silicon and the heavily doped p-type crystalline silicon. In the next video, we will dive deeply into the nature and function of this depletion region. For now, let's just see how this structure will allow us to separate charge carriers. When the solar cell is illuminated, the light penetrates into the solar cell. It is absorbed in the absorber layer. An electron-hole pair is generated. Electron and hole will move randomly. When an electron comes to the edge of the depletion region between the n-type and p-type crystalline silicon, it will feel an electric force that is present in the depletion region. The electron will be pushed by this force to the n-type crystalline silicon. A hole, on the other hand, would be blocked by this electric force because it has the opposite charge. Therefore, only electrons will move to the n-type crystalline silicon, while holes will not pass through this membrane. However, when a hole comes to the edge of the depletion region formed between the p-type and heavily doped p-type crystalline silicon at the bottom of the solar cell, as pictured here, it will be pushed to the heavily doped p-type crystalline silicon. electrons that reach this region will be pushed back into the bulk of the crystalline silicon, so only holes will be collected at the bottom. Photo-generated electrons collected in the N-type crystalline silicon are safe there. The chance that they recombine in the N-type crystalline silicon is extremely small because there are almost no holes available for the recombination process. Similar situation holds for photo-generated holes collected in the heavily doped P-type crystalline silicon. In this layer, there are almost no electrons available to complete the recombination process. Finally, photo-generated electrons collected in the N-type region will charge this region negatively with respect to the heavily doped P-type crystalline silicon region where the photo-generated positively charged holes are collected. We can measure this voltage difference between the N-type and heavily doped P-type crystalline silicon regions through the front and back electrodes that are attached to the respective regions. When the electrodes are connected with each other via an external circuit, the electrons can flow from the N-type region to the region that has a positive potential with respect to this N-type region. When electron flows through the external circuit with the load, it releases part of its energy in the load doing useful work. In this way, the energy of light is converted in the electrical energy that is used to carry out useful work. The electron enters the back contact that has the positive potential in respect to the front electrode. At the interface between the back electrode and the heavily doped P-type crystalline silicon, it will recombine with the hole. The flow of electrons through the external circuit and the recombination with holes at the back contact keeps the current flowing through the circuit. So you see that in a solar cell, an electron is a carrier of energy. An electron does not disappear, but it loses part of the energy in the resistor or, as we call it, load. After releasing part of its energy, an electron has lower energy and will recombine with a hole. To utilize solar power, we need a properly designed solar cell with semi-permeable membranes with attached electrodes to allow collection of only holes or electrons. I did not yet explain what these depletion regions are, which are formed at the interface of two differently doped crystalline silicon materials. So in the following section, we will focus on the properties of the p-n junction and the depletion region in the p-n junction.